So hello everyone, and welcome to this workshop about HPeak 8 of Velocity. So first, before beginning, hope you are all safe and all in good health. Today, we are going to talk about a purpose who perhaps is not very could be very scientific, but my aim is not to do a very theoretical purpose and theoretical post. I would just want to be as most simple as possible, just to give an awareness of what is HPeak 8 of Velocity and how it can impact players and how it can impact yourself. Really to be as simple as possible. There is many scientific research, many scientific things that you can find on the website and on more acknowledged people. So just to give an awareness of everything and hope it could perhaps give you some question and perhaps you will be motivating to search for better understanding of what it is. So the summary of today, we are going to talk about first, so what is HPeak 8 of Velocity? And also other key terms who are linked with that period. What does it mean? And after how this purpose could affect performance, sport performance especially, and how could you deal with that? What will be the area of awareness of you must be careful? And after how could you assess HPeak of Velocity? How could you assess that that tool, how could you be aware of where you are in that period? So to start, I just show you this picture. Take a time to have a look, and we could see that all boys are categorized by size. And if we have just a first look on that, perhaps our first thinking will be, okay, they are categorized by size. So I think we start with the younger player to the older player. But unfortunately, if you have a look of the age group, you could see that it's not the trend. We have some players who perhaps are younger, and they could be one of the taller boys, and perhaps some players who are older and could be in the age group of in the size group of the smaller player. So it's interesting to see the spur pictures to give you an overall view. An overview of everything and see that it's not because you are the older player or the older teenager or the older youth that you are the taller guys. And if we must have you must have the same picture for the girls. So it's not because I have boys that it's only the situation for boys. It's also the same case for girls. But you see, there is really a huge difference. You see the player who was in the middle is U15, and it's just close to a U12 player, and they are the same size. So it's an interesting overview if you want to introduce our purpose today. Another picture I want to start with to introduce or propose is that graph, that chart that we see here, representing the human growth 8 per month from 0 years to 18 years old. So it comes, it is extracted from a CDC and it's connect with the US population. So we could see that the highest peak of growth that we have between 1 year old and 18 year old is at 1 year old. It's the time, the year that you gain 26 centimeters. Yeah, sorry, it's in centimeters, the graphic, but at 1 year old, it's the highest peak of growth that you have in all your adolescence period. And after, if we have a look, we see that we have a second peak, in our adolescence period. It's at around 11 years old for girls and around 13 years old for boys. So it's interesting to see that perhaps we gain centimeters, we gain 8 at 1 year old. After, it's very calm. We don't have any peak of growth. But after, we could see that there is a peak of growth at 11 for girls and 13 years old, for boys. And at the end, after 18, after 19 years old, we reach our adult age. So there is no growth spurt after 18 and 19 years old. So these two first, first picture can give us an overview and a thinking of what could be H peak 8 of velocity. But before going deeper, just to really to introduce some key terms that it's very important just to have connect everything. So adolescence first is between, I will say, the onset of puberty and the end of pubertal growth as it's written. So it's about 8 to 10 years in average, the adolescence. And it's really about an overall of changes. It's physical, it's social, it's psychological. And if we connect with puberty, so puberty, it's only physiological change. And it's really a short period during adolescence, but it's only physiological. So we could say that in the adolescence, there is many changes, and each change will happen at a different period regarding, if you are girls or the boys, and regarding also your individual. Everybody is different as the regarding this this purpose. What is important too, we talk a lot about growth spurts, so it's only linked to the dimension of your body or parts of your body that will grow or will have an growth increasement. But we must be also be careful and be aware of the maturation, who is more connected to biological function. So it's not about dimension of the body who will increase or who will grow. It's more about the brain function and the hormonal function. And it can appear at a different time of the growth. So perhaps you will have, you will grow very quickly. So your height will increase, but you must be careful about also the biological function. So it's not because you grow up that your brain function and hormonal function will already follow this line. But what is important to remember and to retain is that there is many change in our body during the adolescence. So now, APHV is is more a biological indicator. It's and it's about indicate what level of maturation do you have. So it's not about only the size or your height, but it's all about physiological change. So about hormonal change, brain change, and we say connection between brain and muscle, and all that kind of indicators that APHV try to indicate. So it's not only the size, that's the third thing who is important. And after it will show, or the APHV will show how you will experiences your fattest abroad grow. So how do you really have a peak of growth in your adolescence? What is important to say, we just say there is difference between boys and girls. So girls have their APHV 2 years earlier than the boys. So yeah, it's important to notice that. But the peak will be most important for boys. So I will say there will be more increase in for boys during the peak than girls. It will be very more important. So the period, the age where APHV appear for girls will be around 11 and 12 years old. And for boys, it will be around 13 and 14 years old. So you see there is no accurate year age. It's a period. So it really depends of each individual, and it could take time, and everyone will be different regarding the APHV. And that's something is very important to retain. Everyone will grow and develop at different rates and time. So everybody will be different, and there is no one example. Everybody will be different. So we need to understand the individual first and not try to compare to each other. So if we say that APHV it's about biological change, for sure it will impact the athletic performance. So it will impact your strength, your speed, how your breath, the muscle development, your bones, and every biological change will affect performance. It's logical. So if we connect that with your age and all we have said since the beginning of this presentation, we must have the difference between chronological age. So if you have 11, 12 years old, it's about the calendar when you are born. We must try to differentiate that from biological age, who is more about, like you say, your maturation, what's happened in your body. And what's important that it is not a fatality. It's a biological human process. So everybody will go through that age peak, height of velocity. Everybody will go through, but after each one will have a different period to have this age peak of velocity. It will perhaps take longer for people than other. It will be earlier for people than other. It's just a question of time. But must be very careful of difference between your chronological age and biological age. If you remember the first picture about the boys categorized, sorry, by age and size. And if you connect with the chronological age, we see that there is many difference. And it's only about size. It's not about all maturation change, brain and muscle change. So now if we just focus a little about on training now, we see that APHV affect performance. So how could we try to deal with that in training, and how does it affect training? So if there is biological change, for sure you will be more sensitive to different kind of training before you APHV, during and after you APHV. So there will be area of focus that will be more, I will say, where you will be more successful when you will be more aware than other during, before, after you ate PHV. So for example, during your ate PHV, it will be a lot about coordination, aerobic endurance, speed, but short distance, because all your body start to change. And you will have, so we will see just after, we'll have some change in your muscle, tendon, bones. So we must really to focus on agility and coordination. And if you have a focus, for example, on strength, it will be better to do some strength after your APHV, just because your muscle has always starting to develop during your APHV. Your tendon just start to fix on your bone, so we must try to be careful about strength. So during your APHB, it will be important to have a focus on your movement skills, but not only movement skills with the ball, but all the movement skills that you do for walking, running, jumping, all coordination. We'll try really to have a focus on that and try to feel what's happened in your body. Perhaps when you try to run only with one leg do something and the other leg do another things, that kind of stuff. And you will see perhaps some movement that you are used to success before APHV, and during your APHV, you feel more struggling to do it. But after, it will be also a period that could be interesting to you, other attributes to be successful in soccer, for example. I take the, for example, if you are early maturing people, so you were born really at the beginning of the year and you have, so you have a maturation that is early than people who are born at the end of the year of your APHV, you will have more strengths. You will be, you see, perhaps with a bigger size than late maturing people. So perhaps you cannot use your strength, cannot use your speed, because you will have early mature people who have more strength and speed than you. But perhaps could you use other attributes, like game understanding, for example, to have a better positioning to receive the ball and have gain time advantage. You can perhaps more be more focused on your dribble. How could you protect the balls? On that kind of stuff. And on the other way, if you have if you are early mature people and so you have bigger size, bigger strengths, be careful not to focus all your potential into the physical aspect. Try also to use other attributes. So it's important not to judging yourself only on physical aspects during the APHV, before or after. Also, what is important about HPHV, because you will have biological change, it will be a sensitive period of risk of injuries. Yeah, because you, for example, because your body change, first when you grow up, you grew up first by your leg, and after you grew up by your core. So if you first grew up by your leg, you will have tendons where tendons are fixed to your bone. And so if you put too many pressure of on your body, and so the tendons where tendons are fixed to bones, because you start to grow up by your legs, this tendons will increase. So it's, the result can be injury, and especially, you know well, when you feel pain at the knee, at the heel, at the pelvis, this is area where most of injury during HPHV period happen. It's because our body change and we grow up first by your leg, and so they will have tense where tendon. Other things that must be important is that the period when you will gain masses will always follow the HPHV. So it's not at the same time. First, you grow up with the about on the height aspect, on your size aspect, and after you grow up on your mass. So at the beginning, you see that your body, because you grow up first, will not have any protection, not many muscle to protect your bones. It will come after. So that's why all the exercise of strength must be doing very carefully and without charge. So what exercise could we do to prevent injuries during HPHV? So it's lots of stretch to reduce the tense we have between muscle and bones and tendon and bones. Lots of core work just to have our body to understand and to be ready to support charge and stabilization, because our muscle mass will come after. So we must try to really work about stabilization and core work. And I think about girls, especially have a focus on your knee. There is lots of injury at knee levels for girls, especially during HPHV. So all the exercise about stabilization on the knee and prevent the knee, for example, to come inside or to come outside when we run or when we try to do stabilization, all the exercises are important. So to conclude, what we can retain for that, it's training must be gradual, must be progressive. Really be careful not to put too much intensity and volume when you are during your HPHV, but also after. And must go slowly and try to see what is the best for you. Not try to copy what is done to another people, because everybody is different in terms of maturation and HPHV. There is some early or late maturing people. Have a really focused on movement mastering. So about movement, about running, walking, coordination. Try really to have self-awareness of your feeling when you do some things. What's happening in your body? That's the most important for you to see, okay. So I have this sensation. So how could I try to improve that and be really graduate in terms of work? So now, how could we assess and see when will happen how APFV, and if we are at the time of the APFV, or if we are before, if we are after, if you are early or late maturing player. So there is two methods. I am not going to describe these two methods because I'm not a scientist. What perhaps I could tell you is the CamiSwatch method is, I will say, the most accurate method. Sorry, but it's a lot. There's a lot of data and understanding. It's a lot of mathematical calculation. The Mirwald method is, I will say, most common and most easy to do. So it depends of each family, it depends of your environment, it depends of each clubs, what could be the best methods to use to try to assess your APHV. So for sure, like any method that we use, there is no 100% accurate methods. There will be always a scale of mistakes. So always try to be careful and be aware when we do a method that it could be, and it will be no 100% accurate. So we see, just focus on the picture that you have on the right. Yeah, you see two players who play at the same age group, but you see the player with the yellow jersey is certainly early mature than the other player. So in terms of size, in terms, you see, of strength of the body, and I guess in terms of speed and more physical. But it doesn't mean that the late maturing people do not have attributes to be successful. And so it's a lot about try to be aware of your mature level and what could you do to try to improve. And most important, try to work during this time period. So it will be a lot, and I insist, and I want really to be focused on that. It's about time. You need time. It will need time. So sports organization try to reflect since a couple of years about competition organization that we could create to take into account this APHV. And as you see on the picture, how could we try perhaps to have competition where early mature and late mature players could try to develop and enjoy themselves on the field with more success. So Bio Branding is one of these organization, one of these competition organization that is started to be implemented in the federation. It started in Premier League academies in England. And now US Soccer start also to work on this method. This method is how could you allow players to be grouped based on your maturity and your biological age, and not only on your chronological age. So just to finish, I will show you a little video about the explanation of what is bio branding. So just, did you see the video? I don't know if you can just chat, have a chat on the on the chat function, just if you see the video of US soccer. Okay, perfect.
Years old, smaller, weaker, and slower. Since Gabriella and Tyler have matured early, it's easier for them to place more emphasis on their physical attributes and less on their technical ability. At the same time, Diego and Mia are just as skilled, but because they haven't matured as quickly, they struggle to keep up with the speed or physical nature of the game. Children grow and mature at different rates. That's just how it works, right? There's nothing you can do to change that. What's the big deal? In sports like soccer, the difference in maturity at a young age can create a false impression for coaches who often perceive players who mature early to be more talented. The players that mature later might be more technically gifted, but aren't able to show this at the time. That's a problem. In order to improve the overall quality of soccer in the US, it's important for coaches to have the tools to identify and cultivate the best players, not just the ones who mature the fastest. In fact, extensive research has shown that advanced physical attributes observed in youth athletes are poor predictors of success at the adult level. This means that there could be a budding national team or pro player that goes unnoticed just because she or he is a late maturing athlete. This is where biobanding comes in. Biobanding is an effective and accurate method of assessing all young athletes' growth and maturation status. So, how does it work? Biobanding is the process of grouping players based on attributes associated with growth and maturation, rather than chronological age. It's not about playing everyone who is the same height or grouping players by how much they weigh. Rather, with some simple measurements, a bit of research, and using mathematical calculations, it's possible to predict a child's future adult height and the percentage they are from reaching their future stature. By having the growth and maturation information for all players within the chronological age groups, it's then possible to bring players of similar maturity from different age groups to play together. By grouping players this way, coaches can create an optimal environment where both early and late maturing athletes can thrive while supporting them to better identify talent. This creates new challenges for early maturing players who are biobanded with those with similar physical attributes, which encourages them to use and develop their technical and tactical skills. Late maturing players have a greater opportunity to perform in an environment without being suppressed by a lack of physicality, which helps them reach their fullest potential too. Coaches are also able to evaluate a player in a fairer environment, allowing them to judge the player on their overall potential without being biased by their maturity level. This sounds great. Why not bioband every training session and match them? Biobanding is a useful additional tool for player development, identification, and retention, but it shouldn't be thought of as a straight swap for the chronological age group system. Like most things, variety and different challenges are needed to provide the optimal daily environment for players to develop. At US Soccer, we use biobanding and other innovative development tools to help to develop world-class players, coaches, and referees. Doing this brings us even closer to achieving our mission of making soccer the preeminent sport in the United States. For more information, please visit us at US Soccer on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram.
So yeah, we see, so in this short video, biobanding seems to be really an interesting tools to help all the soccer community, coaches, players, parents, to deal with the APHV and provide the best environment as possible for player. But yeah, what's BioBanding just get started as an exp, and it start just get started as an experience in all the federations. So it's just the beginning. So we must, it will take time to see implementation of BioBanding in all every country, in all the clubs. So I would say the first priority is just to be aware of this purpose, aware of the difference of maturation from player, just be aware of that. And what could you do in your team? What could we do in the club to be aware of that and provide the best environment as possible regarding where do we train and how do we train and what are resources? What could we do to provide the best environment? And it will be different for each team, for each clubs. And it, but at the beginning, just be aware is the main aspect. And be aware for player, be aware for coaches, including myself. And you see, it will be difficult to assess. There is not many methods to do it, and methods will take time. So perhaps the best way will be communication about how players are feeling, communication also from how coaches see players and how players are feeling, and do the connection to have a better understanding from each part. And at the end, just to, no matter if you are early or late mature players, just give you the time and give you the right of environment for you to develop as the best as you can. So hope this presentation will be good. I try to be as simple as possible also by trying not to using so too many scientific language. But yeah, hope this just beginning you started to be aware of that. And how could you try to manage the APHV in your training, but also in your life. Thanks for your attention and take care of you and your family. Bye.